This is Wacken Open Air, the biggest gathering of metalheads in the world. Each year, over 60,000 devoted fans come to camp out in the fields of northern Germany to worship their favorite metal bands. And whether you've come to see death metal, power metal, black metal, goth metal, or even Viking metal, if you're a die-hard metal fan, this is the place to be. This is me. My name is Sam Dunn, and as you can see, I'm one of the die-hard metal fans. Ever since I was 12 years old, I've been obsessed with all things metal. And although my parents hoped it was a phase, it wasn't. I grew up, got my graduate degree in anthropology, and then decided to make a documentary about heavy metal culture. In the film, I traced the music back to its working-class roots in the factory towns of England and America. I then showed how early metal bands like Black Sabbath, Deep Purple, and Blue Cheer laid the foundation for a crazy number of metal subgenres. Along the way, I met some of my childhood heroes and spoke to a ton of musicians about the controversy surrounding this music.
Satan.
I also heard from hundreds of metal fans about what this music means to them.
From the time I was 12 years old, metal was just a constant.
And what I discovered is this underground movement is even bigger than I first thought. And for metalheads, it's about more than just music. It's an identity. After the film was released, I got a flood of emails from metal fans thanking me for giving this community the respect it deserves. But what surprised me was how many different countries the emails came from. Many were from places I had no idea metal even existed. I mean, I knew there was metal outside of Europe and North America. One of my favorite bands is Sepultura from Brazil, and I also have metal albums recorded live in Japan. But the stories in these emails got me thinking. For years, anthropologists have studied the effects of globalization, but I've never considered heavy metal's role in this process. As metal has spread across the globe, what new meanings is it taking on for fans in countries with such vastly different cultural, political, and religious backgrounds? Clearly, there's a whole world of metal out there I know nothing about. But I'm not going to find answers in the fields of northern Germany. So I'm taking my anthropology studies on the road to understand how metal has gone global. Yeah! First stop of my journey is Brazil, the largest country in Latin America, and a place most people associate with beaches, soccer, and samba. But if you ask any metal fan, They'll tell you that it's also known for its massive metal scene. So what happened to make metal so huge in this country?
As pessoas nos anos 70 viviam numa ditadura no Brasil. A gente teve uma ditadura de quase 25 anos. Durante uma ditadura, não é muito fácil você ter acesso ou liberdade a qualquer tipo de informação.
And on that period, when we were teenagers, it was very hard to find good instruments. The market was very closed for everything that comes from abroad.
No Brasil, a ditadura acabou em 1985. Nesse momento, as bandas estavam começando a lançar os primeiros discos de heavy metal brasileiros. E o que isso quer dizer é que o heavy metal veio junto com a democracia.
I think the organizers of Rock in Rio felt the momentum. And they organized this festival, which was huge. There were 1,380,000 people during 10 days. And it was the first time, you know, everyone knew what a metalhead was and that there were so many.
Pode parecer engraçado hoje querer ver Whitesnake. É um pouco engraçado, mas ver Whitesnake, Ozzy Osbourne, Scorpions, Iron Maiden, era demais pro brasileiro em 1985.
I wouldn't say that metal came to free us, but I say that it was something that we were begging for. We were begging to have that atmosphere of freedom of speech, freedom of communication.
Hey! Hey! Truman X Truman Nerd! Hey! Let me see your hands in the air! Hey!
We had to fly by helicopter because to get there, all the roads were kind of blocked and stuff. And so as we got, we're getting closer and closer, you know, you could kind of see, you know, you could see all this kind of, it looked like smoke coming up in there, you know. And what it was actually the steam rising
bodies.
Off the bodies, off the crowds. They were all in sync, all having a great time.
Você viu uma multidão de gente que se perdia. Então a gente parecia fazer parte de algo muito maior do que nós. Nós nos sentíamos parte de uma grande família, de uma religião. E as pessoas começaram a imaginar que essa pudesse ser a música, a trilha sonora de um momento que o Brasil era um país novo e livre.
São Paulo, Brazil. We're at the Grandes Galerias, otherwise known as the Galleria do Rock. And I guess you know metal's huge in a country when there's a whole mall devoted to it. I first heard Sepultura when I must have been around 13 or 14 years old. It was hard to believe that there was metal actually coming out of Brazil. It seemed like it was coming from so far away, from a place that was really so different.
Sepultura's founder, Max Cavalera, is one of my all-time metal heroes. And finally, I get the chance to ask him what it was like starting out as an extreme metal band in Brazil.
Well, everything was a struggle, actually, from our own struggle of we didn't know how to play, but we wanted to have a band. Then we didn't have money, but we really wanted to be in a band. The money was never a problem, you know. You go around somehow, you figure out. Even how we look, we find ways. When we saw the Destruction album covers, they had bullet bells. So like, we have to look like those guys, man. You know, I was like, we look like shit, we look stupid, we need bullet bells. I think Igor came up with the idea, well, let's get a bunch of AA batteries, glue them together, take the picture from far, they will look like bullet bells. And I was like, you must be nuts, it's not gonna work. And like, yeah, it works. So you work on those batteries for like a couple of days, and then they look perfect, look great. And it's like, man, cool. Now we got bullet belts, you know, what's next, you know? It was crazy, man. The Brazilian crowd just went nuts from the first note. You know, the entire stadium went crazy, mosh pit. My head's going 1,000 miles an hour, like, this is my country, this is where I grow up. We're playing in the biggest stadium in the world of soccer. All the people that thought Sepultura would never make it, everybody's here watching this, and we're tearing it up. You know, and we're playing everything faster than we ever did.
Soldiers going nowhere. Soldiers blinded by their faith.
Kids identify themselves with them because they were poor. They started out without anything. They just like wanted to play metal and managed to make a living out of it.
A gente falou, não, Sepultura vai ser a nosso grande trunfo, né? Nossa bandeira do metal brasileiro. Porque o Brasil hoje, de certa forma, é reconhecidamente um país que não tem heavy metal, mas hoje também é reconhecido como o país do heavy metal por causa do Sepultura. E falar de Sepultura fora do Brasil é como falar de Pelé, Amazonas, Sepultura do Brasil, very important, muito importante, muito importante.
A few years after I got into Sepultura, they surprised me when they added traditional Brazilian instruments into their music. This shocked a lot of people in the metal community, including their own record company.
I think the owner said like he laughs like, why'd they want to go with a bunch of naked Indians in the middle of the Amazon? Why did they just record the album in New York? You know, something like that. You know, I think they didn't understand at first, but definitely when everything came focused, yeah, the project, that was awesome, man. You know, I think people were like blown away. A lot of countries fall under the idea that we should copy America. And music goes under that too. And I think it sucks, you know, because I don't think we should copy the States. I think we should have our own identity, you know?
That is a huge subway system.
I saw in Brazil how a country's culture can be incorporated into metal music. But what about Japan? a place stereotyped for its obsession with Western culture. It's also known for its hardworking salarymen, conformity, and extreme organization, none of which seems very metal to me. So what happens to metal's rebellious spirit when it mixes with Japanese culture? Hopefully I'll find out at Loud Park, the biggest metal festival in Asia.
Tokyo, Japan!
We came to Japan, we played a theater. We had like a, I think it was like a 3,000 seater theater. And they were all, everybody was sitting in their seats. And they had ushers in every aisle.
So we came here, you know, not having any idea what was gonna happen. Not believing they were gonna sit down, because I'm like, there's no way you can sit down and watch a Slayer show. It just ain't gonna happen.
And the minute we started playing, they got up and they rushed to the front. And the promoter at the time freaked out. They had never seen an audience just get up their seats and rush. You know, and we were sitting there playing, and all of a sudden while we were playing, you could see all the ushers were like doing this. They made everybody get back in their seats. And everybody, so for the rest of the show, they sat in their seats. They did this.
Now the Japanese are moshing. Now the Japanese are body surfing. We've seen that complete evolution from when it wasn't allowed at all to now it's kind of like commonplace.
ね、日本のメタルファンの考え方は欧米の人たちの考え方とは違うと思うよ。全然違う。で、例えばその社会への反抗だとか、社会への不満みたいなものをねメタルに求めているかといったら多分ほとんどがノーだな。例えばね、日本で社会への反抗とかね、それからその自分が社会の中で孤立していてその何かその代償みたいなものをメタルに求めているかって言ったら全然違うよ。
で、例えばそのロックフェスティバルでも一緒ですけれども、あの非常にね彼らは礼儀が正しい。あのゴミを捨てたりしてもそれを拾って持って帰ろうとする。自分がそのヘビーメタルのファンであると、例えばそれが悪魔的なイメージで語られるかもしれないけれども、それはコンサートの最中にこう乗っている時はそういうポーズをするんですけれども、そこから一旦離れると非常に礼儀正しい青年に戻るという感じです。
わ
これも普段はあのスーツにネクタイして、やってるんですけど、やっぱりそういう普段の毎日のなんていうのかな、日常っていうか、それからああいう、まあ、メタルみたいな激しい音楽を、まあ、家であったりこういうライブだったりで聞いてると、一気にそうなんていうのかな、日日常にこう変わるっていうか、
気持ちが楽しくなる楽しくなるし、弾ける。
Sometimes Japan gets a little bit of a bad rap from people because of the way people kind of interact at the shows, or the lack of interaction or whatever. And to me, that's horseshit. I mean, it's just, it's a different way of expressing themselves, and we love going there, and we love all the toothbrushes that we get. We were wondering, of course, in the beginning if there was anything, we had bad dental hygiene or bad breath or whatever, but then again, you realize that it's just, it's their love. It's their way of showing love. Here, I have a toothbrush with some Japanese teddy bear on it or whatever, and it's like, okay, thank you.
Do you like metal?
Yeah. I like metal!
Okay, and cut.
Okay.
Yes, thank you. I wish all my interviews were that easy.
Loud Park, I found the new generation of Japanese metal fans. But now I'm on the hunt for some of the old guard to discover how metal arrived in this country. Rumor has it, they hang out at Blackmore's, a small bar named after Deep Purple's legendary guitarist, Ritchie Blackmore.
Nobody ever be that kind of got to let into the crowd. Nobody gonna be my daddy, gonna be something alive.
同じ1972年の8月に、特に僕なんかはディープアップルって割とこう整合性のある様式美のあるバンドできっちり演奏するバンドかなと思ったら、そうじゃなくてインタープレイをガンガンガンガンあのパフォーマンスに持ち込んで、最後は多分僕もね、初めて見た光景だけど、武道館の前の方にお客さんが殺到しちゃってね、わーって殺到して、リッチー・ブラックマーがギターをグリグリ回したりするわけ。ディープパープルが伝説と化した夜だったと思うね。今ね、50代の人たちがもう一度大学時代や高校の時にやってた友達とバンドをやるっていうのは日本はね盛んなの。そういう人たちが必ず練習スタジオでやってるのはハイウェイスターなの。そしてみんなギタリストになりたくて、あそこのソロだけ弾きたいんだよ。だからボーカルが大変らしい。キーが出ない。うん、本当で。キスはそれから数年遅れて日本にやってきて。飛行機から降りてくるときはメイクして衣装のまま飛行機から降りてきたの。ところがそれだってイミグレーションが通れないので、一回メイクを落としてイミグレーションを出て、その後にまたメイクをして衣装に着替えて、だってだってステージ衣装のままイミグレーションから出てきて、何千人ものファンがバーって、もう70年代のあの映像今見たらね、多分ね失神するぐらい。
ポップな曲作りとか、そういう火を使った、ステージングっていうのにとても、みんな驚いた。メイクをしてでステージに立つっていうのは割と普通に受け入れるんで。
やっぱりにキスっていうのは日本人にとっては何かその歌舞伎を連想させるっていう意味ですごくこう感情移入するものがあったし、
spending some time in Japan, I realized there's a lot more going on than just obsession with Western culture. This place is unlike anywhere I've ever experienced. But I still need to know if the Japanese have done anything unique with heavy metal music.
Welcome. It's good times. We're going to meet Marty Friedman, guitar god.
I'm a multi-platinum artist from a major band called Megadeth that has rocked Japan so many times, rocked the whole world, and yet I choose to live in Japan and play Japanese pop music and be on Japanese variety TV shows. In Japan, taboos are off. I mean, there's all kinds of mixes, and like, for example, I'm about to do this project that I was telling you about before called Death Panda, where I'm playing this full-on metal music, but it's going to be sung by 48 teenage girls. That could never happen in America or in other countries, or, you know, where the way I grew up. Every single culture has something really cool to offer. And metal, you know, I think it was like America and England, you know what I mean? And then the other countries did their own slant on it. And Japan, my favorite kind of Japanese metal is Visual K music. Visual K is a phenomenon that is unbelievable. It's guys that are dressed up in gorgeous, I guess kind of glam meets goth meets really, really extravagant heavy metal. Not Twisted Sister guys wearing their mom's clothes kind of feminine. The makeup, it's beautiful. Of all the bands that were doing visual music, X-Japan became the biggest and by far the most versatile musically.
I started playing the piano when I was four, a classical piano. The first concert I saw was Kiss. I think I was 9 or 10 years old. I went to see Kiss with my mother. So that pretty much changed my life.
At the beginning, music industry hated us. We are like a black sheep of the family, completely. Yeah, nobody even want to interview with us. But eventually, yeah, we sold 20 million albums. So they had no choice.
X-Japan is probably the first thing that really got me into Japanese rock music. And why? Because it's got the fastest, heaviest music next to these sappy, sappy ballads. And I happen to love sappy ballads, but like I would never, as an American, have the guts to put it on an album next to a song that sounds like Fight Fire with Fire. You know, they got songs that sound like Barry Manilow that come right after like these full-on metal epics, and I'm like, how can they do this? And the people who listen to the Japanese domestic rock and heavy sounding music, they don't even know really that the international heavy metal bands exist. It is very likely they've never heard of Metallica. So it is very interesting how these two genres can exist and they don't like each other and they sound so similar. The people who like the international bands like at Loud Park, they don't think the Japanese stuff is very cool.
So what is Visual K? I guess what makes it not metal, in your opinion?
Because metal is something cool. That's the answer.
If someone busted out into colored paper, you just might spot it.
So far, I've visited countries with well-established metal scenes. But in India, the scene is just getting started, and no major metal bands have played here. Back in school, I would always read about India in my anthropology textbooks. It's one of the world's oldest and most distinct cultures. But I can see it's quickly modernizing. And metal isn't the only Western influence that's starting to creep in.
People love the camera in India. They know this is a film, a film's being made, and they're excited. You know, they can't get close enough. A case in point. I have to say, it's pretty obvious that this is the home of Bollywood.
Bollywood, in short, is a really, really cheesy movie with a hell of a lot of songs and dancing around trees.
It's one of the biggest industries in India, I mean. And all the Indian kids are listening to remixes and indie pop stuff and, like, you know, basically whatever the channels are showing, that's what people are absorbing.
Not just among young people, throughout, I mean, right from the villages to the richest guy in India, probably. They're all fans of Bollywood music.
It's got to be catchy, it's got to be bouncy. You can shake their ass to it and stuff like that. At the end of the day, it's just nothing. There's no meaning to it.
It's a very soft, timid kind of music for very, you know, weak-hearted kind of people. So I don't relate to all that. I want my music to be strong. So that's why I relate to metal.
Metalheads in Mumbai have told me about the problems they have finding venues to put on metal shows. Recently, they've been having them at a beach motel on the north side of the city, a venue that's more known for Hindu weddings than extreme metal concerts.
Fucking metal!
For us, metal is something special, you know. It's like, I grew up with Priest, Maiden, Sabbath, Dio, all these bands. And every time, say I put on a Priest CD, I feel like I'm practically moved to tears, you know, sometimes.
People who listen to metal are very passionate about the music. I guess they can identify with it. It gives you sort of a identity of your own.
It also makes a statement that, you know, we aren't exactly going to just be force-fed or conform to anything and everything that society asks us to do. We have our own way of thinking, our own way of living. You know, we want to follow our own path in life. Especially in India, where society tells you what to do, who you're supposed to be, where you're supposed to work, who you're supposed to marry, all that shit, yeah.
It's not like the American system or like the system in the West where, like, you know, the kid moves out after he turns 18. Like, people still live with their parents till, like, you know, they grow old out here.
It's like, you know, our parents are our, you know, they are our gods. Whatever they say has to be right for us. It need not be necessarily correct all the time.
How do your parents feel about you listening to metal music?
ये क्या बकवास सुन रहे हो यार?
Hey, भगवान, ये क्या कर दिया मेरे बच्चे को?
Quit playing the fool. You know, you've passed the age now. Get serious about your studies, your career. You have to get married soon.
Why? And what for?
What is this crap you're listening to? For God's sake, please stop listening to all this.
So on one side, we've got the metal show, the local Mumbai metal show. On the other side, we have a traditional Indian wedding, so let's go check it out.
People here are mostly religious, very orthodox. You know, people are only off late opening up to newer things and becoming different, you know, open-minded.
The metal crowd is
are all people who are actually, like, many of them are engineers, okay, graduates, postgraduates from top shot colleges. So all are actually intellectual, they think, but they're ready to stand up for what they believe.
Like, there's a lot of discrimination that happens otherwise in society out here with caste, creed, religion, sex, whatever you want to call it. Like, but within metal, they're very open to people of any caste, religion, creed, whatever. There's no specifications or classifications in metal. It's just, it combines the whole community together.
We, as a band, follow one religion that is called music. I am a Hindu by birth. And the others are Christians, they are Maharashtrians, they are, you know, people who follow different religions, all right? But, you know, that doesn't hamper us from making music, which is universal. Music is, you know, one language. It's just like the sky above us, you know? It is one for everyone.
So we can have a guy wearing a Gandhi shirt and a guy wearing an Iron Maiden shirt in the same band.
Yes. We have Gandhi in our hearts. We have Mahatma Gandhiji in our hearts.
And Maiden in your hearts.
And Maiden in my heart.
It's been an honor for all of us. And may you succeed in all walks of life. And yes, that's it. This is considered very sacred, very holy. And we are giving India to you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
It's an honor.
Thank you. Do I wear it?
Yeah.
If you wish to, yes.
Do people wear them?
Yeah. Yes, they do.
Here we go. This is Hindi black metal right here. Hindi black metal. Symphony.
Visiting India makes me realize that my anthropology textbooks are seriously out of date. This country is going through massive changes, and my new Indian metal friends are part of an emerging middle class. For them, metal is a way to connect to a global culture and break free from the restrictions they feel in their traditional society. But India isn't the only country in this region going through massive changes. China is increasingly opening up to the West, but the government still keeps tight control on the music and culture they officially let into the country. And at this point, I'm not even sure we'll get through customs, traveling with 300 kilograms of film equipment on tourist visas.
In China, I will be known as S. De.
De.
De. It's a big kind of hassle trying to get the visas and stuff like that, so we don't really know what's going to happen.
What are we going to say?
We're going to say we're here on a holiday. We've just come to Beijing for a holiday because it's in the neighborhood.
Next, please.
Hello.
Thank you.
That was easy.
Did he ask you anything?
Nothing. Nothing. We just walked right through. Welcome to China. Biking in Beijing, man. I don't know if it's good for the health exactly. I don't know, it feels good to ride, but I'm choking on the pollution, to be honest.
China is home to 1/5 of the world's population, and where probably 90% of my metal t-shirts were made. And yet, like India, no major metal band has ever played here. But searching the internet, I found one place where they sell metal music, the 666 Rock Shop in downtown Beijing.
Hey guys, how are you?
I'm
Sam.
Hi,
welcome
to China.
Good
to see you.
循规蹈矩，听就是老师的话，听家长的话，接受一切别人告诉我们的方式，存在方式，然后没有自己的独立的思考，然后也没有
没有自由的权利可以说话，然后通过这种音乐我们可以慢慢的说我自己想要说的，做我自己想要做的，然后不去管别人有任何想法。
老一代的人，就是父母这辈的人以上，一直受到是中国的传统教育，就是包括像什么老子啊，或者是共产的这种概念，都是混杂在一起的。中国的家长现在不知道该面对一个突然要留长头发的一个男孩，或者是去纹身，或者去学吉他。
学校成立是在1993年成立，那时候中国刚刚开放不久，那么会有很多的年轻人想学现代音乐。学校的学生在学校，他们要学不同的音乐风格，所以他们要学重金属，要学布鲁斯，那么当然在二年级他们要学爵士乐，要学即兴 improvisation。
One, two, three。
我们曾经有过20年的一种封闭的状态，然后没有任何外界的文化影响进入到中国。在音乐上面，尤其是摇滚乐，摇滚乐在西方已经是五十多年的历史，可是在这50多年的这个课程，他们需要在十几年内要学会。
A lot of countries, big bands from the West come and tour, but in China it's very different. It hasn't had major metal bands play here. How did metal come to China?
80% 的人认识年轻人认识重金属是听一个中国的重金属乐队的专辑，就是唐朝唐 Dynasty， 它是中国应该是第一个重金属乐队，而且也是非常优秀的重金属乐队。
Amazing. Believe it. Believe I'm here.
It's a bit surreal, actually.
I'm Kaiser, and I was born in upstate New York. And around the time I was 12, I think I bought my first Kiss album. And it wasn't until I moved to China for the first time in 88.that I started playing in a pure metal band. That band was called Tang Dynasty. The real story of my coming here and deciding to play rock starts with a little shitty Roland Cube 60 amp and then a guitar, and I came out here just sure I was going to find some metal musicians.When I got here, the first thing that happened was I ran into this guy named Ding Wu. Ding Wu's got some fucking blues chops. I mean, he's like bending strings, he's sliding up and down the neck. But one thing he didn't know how to do, really, was make a guitar really overdrive. He didn't really know, I mean, he didn't have effects boxes or anything like that. So anyway, then the lessons began, where I did my whole sort of Jack Black, school of rock, history of rock lessons, the family trees. And I said, Ding Wu,You are a metal guy. I mean, it's clear to me that you are a metal guy. I mean, that you should be a fucking headbanger. I mean, you are. He can sing like a goddamn banshee. And he had this like bewitching charisma. I mean, just a beautiful stage presence. And so I just knew, dude, man, we're gonna make the greatest band that China will ever see. Bye.Phenomenon like Tang Dynasty, we did real well and we packed stadiums and stuff, but most of the people who came were not metal fans. They were just sort of interested in this phenomenon. They thought it was, you know, a curiosity. When we used to tour, people would just sit there sort of slack-jawed, staring, not knowing what the fuck we were. You know, I'd hear people constantly shouting, 哥们儿，你这头发真的假的 ？Which means, hey, buddy, is that hair real? The metal look works for Chinese males. The ship sprouts out of our head quite naturally, and it looks pretty good. I mean, that echoes also with, I mean, all the great warriors of ancient times, you know, sometimes they tie it up like this or whatever, but, you know, but it's long hair. And so that resonates for sure. You know, long hair means sort of, you know, martial prowess.
Tang Dynasty is how most people heard about metal in China. But how did they find out about Western metal?
Prior to, say, 1994, almost every bit of music that came into China that was of the metal ilk was from students or children of diplomats or children of, like, of multinational corporations who made tapes or made copies or ripped them or whatever. And then that stuff circulated. What really turned on the tap here was the advent of what are called CD catalog cutouts. When an artist is cut out of a repertoire from a record company to realize some tax savings, they destroy inventory. And of course, they don't actually destroy it. They call, you know, like, you know, Tony Fizzucci's trucking company that comes and take them straight to the shipping yard and then hauls us away to China.
You can find any music in there, jazz, blues, classical, metal music, everything.
Suddenly, all this stuff was available, dirt cheap. I mean, really affordable for Chinese people. I mean, most of it was shit. I mean, there's a reason why these artists were cut out of the repertoire, I suppose. But there were always, like, there were always diamonds in there as well.
Heavy metal in China has come a long way since Tang Dynasty and illegal glam metal CDs. In Beijing, I've discovered a growing underground music scene, a scene that is producing the darkest, most extreme metal I've heard on my journey so far.
My name is Nong Yong. I'm 34 years old. I should be from 小就非常喜欢音乐，但是我喜欢上重金属应该是在1998年。我想音乐原来还能以这种形式来玩，我非常的震惊那时候。所以说我就组织了一个乐队，开始玩这种音乐。当时也算在中国，我应该是比较早的，最早的一批第一批乐队。本身我自己也是具备这种情绪，每当我就生活上受到挫折或者不顺不如意的时候，我就内心非常感到非常黑暗。但这种黑暗我怎么去表达呢？我就选择了音乐。
最主要的对于学生来讲，就是给他了一个表达激情的一个工具，而且是很直白的，很直接的一个工具。更渴望表现自己的愤怒，啊，更渴望表现自己的激情。文化大革命的尾期，我的童年就觉得，年轻人如果有愤怒的话或者有压抑，他们就要打架，他们会在校门口会一起打群架，互相打，然后很凶猛。所以我觉得摇滚乐来到中国其实是帮助中国政府解决了一些社会问题，因为有很多的年轻人啊，他可以通过音乐来表达自己的情怀。中国的重金属乐队，
他们的音乐里反映了很多
中国的不公平的事情，政治方面不健全的事情，贪官污吏干的一些坏的事情，有些中国人生活不好，贫困，或者是受到不公平的待遇，这种事情。
I think that we're coming into a time now where China's finding its footing. It can be something that is at once distinctly modern and unashamedly modern, and distinctly and unabashedly Chinese. That's the movement that I want to be a part of.
So I've just traveled to two of the world's most populous countries, India and China, where no major metal bands have ever toured. And yet in the middle of the Pacific Ocean, an impoverished nation with the largest Muslim population in the world has had several big metal concerts, even while under an oppressive dictatorship.
We're now facing the biggest population in the world, with nearly 300 million people living in Indonesia.
Unemployment here is staggeringly how bad unemployment is. I mean, officially, it's only like 10 or 11%, but unofficially, it's probably more like 40%.
Right.
You know, and that's a lot of people. It's a big country.
You convene like the most plush corporate high-rise, you know, area, and then right next to it, there's like shanties right there on the street. I mean, people literally live in the gutter.
And it's ironic to see so many poor people in the country who has a mountain of diamonds, sea of gold. That's ironic, huh? That's Indonesia.
Hello, Indonesia! Non-conformity in my inner self! Walking these dirty streets with hell in my mind. Fears guard the world. I work for the rules. What the nation's eyes.
I think there's a whole thing connected to Brazil and where I'm from. Fans connect to third world lyrics because this is their lyrics. When I'm singing about inner self of growing up in these fucked up streets and shit.
The Indonesian fans, reading some of those lyrics, they feel connected to it.
Sepultura are coming from the third country as well, and Indonesia, with poor injustice everywhere, starving people, you know, the corruption. They're singing about that too in their lyrics.
You know, it's some match with what happened in this country all over the years.
Halfway through the show, the kids got so crazy. Fucking place. Chaos, man. Hell broke loose in the mosh pit. A couple minutes after that, they stopped the entire show and had these huge bamboo sticks. And they were like kind of beating like the first row of kids. And they made 20,000 people sit down on the floor without making one sound. You know, like, I never seen anything like that in my life. You know, it was like, none of us, man. I think we're like, holy shit.
We played for the first time ever here. We're so fucking proud to be playing in front of you. I'm sorry for everything that happened tonight.
It's a lot similar. The kids in Brazil or in Eastern Europe, rebellion, fucking pissed off, real pissed off about the shit, the way the life is how they had to, you know, they grew up in this shithole and pretty much gonna die in this shithole. So what do you do about it, you know? So metal comes in.
People were coming from everywhere, from Jogja, from Surabaya, even from Bali. Everyone from Medan, people come just to see Metallica.
I have to sold my father's shoes so I can afford the tickets. So yes, of course, I have my father's angry at me.
I remember driving to the gig. There were a fuck of a lot of people outside, and the stadium was in a very rich part of Jakarta, where a lot of the politicians and a lot of the old money family lived. So here were thousands and thousands of young kids with a lot of kind of adolescent that, you know, and Metallica was on the other side of these stadium walls, and we were playing and a bunch of people couldn't get in and so on. And then obviously pretty much all hell broke loose out there. Sitting up on stage playing, doing our thing, and you can see like fires and smoke and all the, you know, police sirens and, you know, all that crap. And it was just, they basically just fucking tore the whole neighborhood up.
The army chased us and was like, I was yelling, sir, I got tickets, I want to get in the stadium. We can't get in the stadium. And he was like staring at us, you black t-shirt Fox, you are all communist, and then start swaying about everything, and we just run away.
And I got hit in my head too. Even I got the ticket, they just hit everything. No matter you, whether you got ticket or not, they just hit everything.
After the Metallica's concert, they banned all the metal show. They banned all the rock concert from the international acts, of course, because it's out that it's kind of bring a bad impact for Indonesian youth. Because, you know, it's like a mass demonstration.
Yeah.
It's like a mass demonstration, just like what we had in 1998, the May Revolution, while Suharto stepped down by the student movement.
After Suharto stepped down, there was some sort of unleash of this, like holding back energy that during Suharto era you cannot really express. So everywhere, and people all of a sudden got sort of liberated from all this, you know, oppression. You know, like 32 years is not a short period. You know, so they feel like now I can do almost anything.
Not long after Suharto stepped down, we have a very political underground scene here.
In Jakarta, most metal bands sing about social and political issues, something I associate more with punk rock than metal. But Indonesia's most popular metal band, Tengkorak, has started to incorporate more controversial ideas.
What are you trying to say through Tengkorak's music?
Kita juga ada beberapa tema-tema yang ketidaksetujuan kita dengan kelompok negara kapitalis yang selalu memojokkan negara-negara yang sedang berkembang gitu kan. Seperti mayoritas penduduk kita di Indonesia ini adalah muslim. Mereka mengatakan bahwa ada beberapa negara yang kategorikan sebagai negara teroris, dan itu kita sangat tidak setuju dan tidak respect gitu dengan itu ya.
Most of the songs have a very strong political or social commentary, but there was one song which was called, I think, Destroying Zionism. What are you expressing through that song?
Ada Zionis itu adalah sebuah sistem yang dibikin oleh kaum Yahudi. Kaum Yahudi ini mempunyai sistem gitu. Sistem ini yang sangat sesat. Dia tujuannya itu emang untuk menghancurkan umat Islam gitu pada intinya gitu kan. Zionis itu emang harus benar-benar di destroy ya kan. Jadi tidak perlu ada lagi gitu. Bahkan kalau perlu Israel dihapuskan dari peta dunia kan.
People would hear that song and then see your jacket with a swastika and a slash through it. Do you think they might see that as a bit of a contradiction?
Tapi bukannya masalah Yahudinya yang di sini yang kita ini yang kita tidak setuju dan kita tentang gitu.
The right wing politics, the religious leader, they kind of more to teach people of Indonesia, you gotta live in Islam way. Me, I was born Islam, but I don't trust that religion anymore, because for me, religion it's individual, it's only between you and God.
Muslim itu mengajarkan kedamaian. Semua agama mengajarkan kedamaian. Tidak mengajarkan untuk memusuhi orang, berperang dengan orang lain. Itu hanya orang per orangnya aja, human per humannya aja yang memaksakan kehendak pada orang. Dan itu bukan orang baik. Apapun agamanya, mau Muslim, mau Kristen, mau apa, itu bukan orang baik menurut gua.
That's good. Let's stay up. Yeah. There you go. Ready.
Something.
In the same place? I'm in a mosque in Indonesia, and it's the end of Ramadan, so it's Friday, so it's a big prayer day, and we're going in with our new friend Rudy. First foot bath I've had in a long time.
Yang Muslim ya harusnya kayak ya kayak gua, kayak orang-orang yang lu lihat itu biasa aja. Sembahyang, pergi kerja, ya kayak gua aja yang lu lihat normal. Tidak ada Muslim. Metal is for my life. Metal is for life. Make a relationship with friend. Just hear the music. Take a spirit. It's only for life. But religion is my relation vertically with my God.
Music has never shied away from controversy. It has always rebelled against authority and stood up against mainstream religion. But as I was reminded in Indonesia, in rare cases it can be a voice of hatred. Well, if there's one place that's had a history of dealing with hatred, it's Israel. So I'm curious to know how this has affected the metal being created here.
I think there isn't any other place special as Jerusalem. The culture of this place, this land, it's very complicated, it's very ancient on one hand, and it's very mixed on the other hand. We have here a Jewish cemetery, we have a church over here, and we have a mosque over there. Old Jerusalem is like this. It's some kind of a harmony of colors, of praying. Everyone was here. Abraham, Jesus, Muhammad. I think that it's important for an artist to reflect his place, his culture.
The fact that we live in probably one of the most controversial places on Earth and probably one of the more hostile places on Earth, it gets in you, you know, this effect of violence everywhere and battle and stuff like that. And probably that's why we could be heavier than other bands in other places of the world.
אבל כשהתחלתי להיכנס לתוך התחום של הבלק מטה, גדלתי על רוב הלהקות הנורווגיות. ואהבתי אותם מאוד והתחברתי אליהם מאוד, כי הם שרו על דברים שבדיעבד הבנתי שזה ספרים שהם קראו והאימא של האימא של האימא של דורות לפני. אבל כשאנחנו התחלנו לראות את מה שהם כותבים בספרים, אנחנו התחלנו לראות בעיניים שלנו, כי חיים את זה באמת.
Witness to something and you come to write a song, your song will be more real than someone who just read about it in history lesson. Because we live in a country when insanity became closer to reality.
בתוך ירושלים, בתוך הכותל המערבי, בתוך האזור כולו. שלושת הדתות הגדולות שזה אסלאם, נצרות ויהדות גורמות למלחמות האלה. תמיד יהודים שחטו נוצרים, נוצרים שחטו מוסלמים, מוסלמים שחטו יהודים וגם וזה פשוט חוזר חלילה.
When kids in Israel turn 18, they have to go to the army. That's one of the things that drew me most to playing extreme music. Cuz I finished school and I'm supposed to go to the army, but like fuck that. I'm not going to be a part of that or do that. And I want to do another thing. I want to play in a band and I want to go travel the world and meet other people that like the same things that I like.
אני חושב שאם לא נעשה צבא, פשוט יגמרו אותנו, ישמידו אותנו. אז אני לא חושב שכאילו יש לי איזשהו חיבה לזה או משהו, אבל אנחנו צריכים לעמוד קדימה כדי שפשוט לא יבלעו אותנו, זה הכל. כאילו אין פה, פשוט זה חיה, אתה חייב לעשות את זה.
At first, Salem was occupied with the occult, hence the name, you know, Salem witches. But then you realize that your reality is scarier than any Mesopotamian demon you can summon. Like, it's scarier that I walk down the street and someone will show up and explode just because he hates me. I'm usually not scared to walk down the street and be attacked by demons. Or Pinhead from Hellraiser. Doesn't scare me. I watch the movies, I think they're funny. I like them. I'm more scared of the living and their actions. Someone from the Israeli parliament got mad at Salem because we covered a song that was identified with the Holocaust. And he said, the Holocaust is sacred. You cannot play metal music to it. You cannot play it now in bars or where people will headbang or dance or hug or... Holocaust is sacred. There was someone else from the parliament who said, wait, it's the best vehicle for the new generation to learn about the Holocaust.
Particularly contentious, and that is the song Angel of Death by Slayer. I mean, how do you feel about a song, you know, Auschwitz,
the meaning of pain,
the way that I want you to die. How do you feel about that?
Well, I don't know if Slayer actually meant of I don't know if their intention was to hurt the Jewish people when they sang about it. I don't think they are a Nazi band.
I think that song is probably the most controversial song in the history of metal. And I won't lie to you, it also disturbed me because my father was in the Holocaust. But I don't look at it in a negative way. I do play it on my stereo and I do play it as a DJ. So I don't take it personally.
I translate Slayer, Angel of Death, to they were against the Holocaust. If they were for it, they will deny it. Won't tell a huge 4-minute story about it.
So do you think Angel of Death is sort of...
It's a monument.
It's against it because it's exposing the horrors of it? And that
it's a monument of the horrors that shouldn't be repeated.
Although Slayer is not a Nazi metal band, there are a small number of bands out there that do promote Nazi ideas. Varg Vikernes, otherwise known as Count Grishnok, was imprisoned for church burning and murder in Norway and is known for his fascist and racist ideas. I was surprised to find out that there's also an Israeli connection to this story.
The year was 90. Salem was just after releasing a live demo called Million Slaughtered. It was time of the tape trading and the Norwegian black metal scene just started.
That's how Grishnok heard us. The title song, The Million Slaughtered, talks about the Holocaust. So I guess being whoever he was, he wrote us back that the music was great, but those lyrics are stupid, you know? It's too bad that Hitler didn't finish the job that he started, and it was just before the Gulf War. May Saddam finish you all. And again, you know, this was not just lyrics that were written and were detached from it. It's part of us. So obviously, we were getting angrier. So we got a very angry reply using some cuss words I'm not sure you want me to repeat here. And about a couple of months later, we police knocks on the lead singer's door and goes, "Who hates you in Norway? No, we just got a bomb in the mail."
That we go, everybody only knows the bad news, the war and stuff like that. And we try to show or to be some kind of a good news coming out of Israel. When we played in Turkey, you always see people in the crowd, they sing with us together and they do like this with their hands. Now this is what usually the Muslims are doing when they pray. It's like they are holding the Quran book. It's amazing. It's metal people. All these wars between religions, all this massacre at the name of God, this is a big confusion. We all believe in the same God, and we can stop all this bloodshed and confusion and war. I mean, if we will think about the dark, we did nothing. There is plenty of darkness in this world. I think this is why we should speak about the light.
Of all the metal fans that contacted me from around the world, I was most shocked to hear from people in Iran. But because of the increased tensions in the area, my visa application was denied and I couldn't get into their country. So instead, we're meeting the Iranians in Dubai, where metalheads from throughout the region are gathering for Desert Rock, the only metal festival in the Middle East.
My name is Armin, and I'm 28, turned 29 2 days ago. And well, I'm an engineer, actually, a mechanical engineer. That's what I do for a living, but metal has been with me since my teenage era, and I truly love it, you know?
Can you tell me about some of the restrictions that have been placed on getting access to metal in Iran?
You don't have any CDs sold. This is the biggest restriction. The music cannot go on. So you cannot sell metal t-shirts. Before that, even jeans were forbidden. Long hair, I was just caught up for just having long hair by the police.
They took me to police office and said, why do you have long hair such like that? And are you worshiping Satan or are you in those kind of bad metal bands?
I got caught by the religious police for wearing a Slayer t-shirt and having long hair. I was just back from a Slayer concert in Turkey, so I was very, you know, I almost forgot how restricted this thing is.
I know of a couple of friends who were put in jail. They had their heads shaved and they were beaten up because the authorities really thought they were Satanists, and they were not. It just looked metal.
They consider it anti-moralistic, and they say that it's bringing a lot of excitement, which is not good for a music like in Islamic context. There had been some limited gigs, like 2 or 3 years ago. There was this gig and a band's called STS. They were covering up like from Morbid Angel and Slayer, but no vocals was allowed. They said vocals are too harsh and aggressive, and we had to be seated. Later on, they canceled all the shows. With the system that we have right now, we cannot perform Western music, not only metal. And so the metal community in Iran has grown really isolated from what had been in the real world.
Someone that we knew had sent us a picture. They had gone to Iran to go visit family. And they took a picture of Slayer spray painted on a wall in Iran. And they took a picture standing next to it so they could, you know, so to identify that they were there and that this was there and this is Iran. And I just kind of looked at that, you know, and I thought, wow, Slayer in a Muslim country. You know what I mean? That to me just screams death.
We met with Tom in Japan, and he described a photograph of a Slayer logo that had been spray painted on a wall.
Wow, yeah, we got lots of that, yeah.
Have you ever seen something like that in your country?
I have done something like that in my country, okay?
In a lot of the Middle East, conservative governments and religious authorities repeatedly censor and restrict metal music. But the city of Dubai seems completely open to anything Western and is one of the fastest growing tourist destinations in the world. So I'm going to talk to some metal fans who were born and raised here to get their thoughts on the spread of metal throughout the region.
My full name, like in the Arabic tradition, is Omar Abdulaziz Muhammad Khan Abdullah. Our licenses are like this wide, driver's license. Basically, this is called Kandora, or a lot of the expats call it a dish dash, okay? And this is a Ghatra. And basically, it's not a Ku Klux Klan outfit. It's basically mostly white to reflect the heat of the sun, because it's really hot here, mm-hmm. and it gets really uncomfortable. But they do come in different colors, and they are extremely, extremely comfortable, and they have very good ventilation.
Good for playing metal in, too.
Well, I actually, the airflow going. In high school, I played Purple Haze on stage with a black one of these and a bandana.
Metal is generally coming from the West, and I guess in a way it's part of the process of globalization. What's your opinion on metal and its spread around the world?
If you say globalization, I know a lot of, like 1,500 years ago, a lot of the ideas from the East, you know, during the Dark Ages, crept from the East to the West. And I think it's just a cycle, you know. You guys discover something cool, okay, bring it over. Okay, oh, that's a nice instrument the Arabs play, the oud. Okay, let's use that one in my song. And mm-hmm. the Indians have the sitar, okay, let's mix that. I mean, I don't think it's a bad idea when it naturally happens.
Right.
If you want to talk about the IMF and the World Bank, then we can discuss.
With the help of internet, obviously internet was a main driver for globalization, because it's just easy to reach information to reach anywhere.
I don't think anyone in the world benefited from MP3 downloading as much as we did, because we started discovering new bands through the internet, downloading their music and listening to it, especially when we couldn't get it. We didn't have any access to it. I apologize to all the bands, but we had to do this. That was the only way we could discover them.
So Lars, you know, most of the fans we're meeting around the world, the only way they can get music is by downloading it on the internet. You know, how do you feel about that?
I think it's a great thing, yeah. I think it's great. I mean, obviously, it's the way to share this stuff, and I think it's awesome. I think that we were somewhat flabbergasted at the at some early internet things that were going on a few years ago, but we're at peace with that, and we just championed it like everybody else. What the internet has done, you know, which is a great thing of bringing everything, you know, and making everything available and global and so on. I mean, it's just awesome. I mean, listen, at this point, if kids can get their hands on the music, then it's a great thing.
Now you can download music, you can access everything. So it's easy for most of the people around the Middle East to listen to metal. It's gonna grow. It's fucking gonna grow.
The Desert Rock Festival is like a yearly anniversary for metalheads, basically. I mean, Lebanon, Kuwait, Bahrain, Oman, Doha, Saudi Arabia, you can name every Middle Eastern country. There's people out here tonight for it.
Yeah, baby, it's about time!
You remember my name? Then time went backwards. That's reality. Black line. Come on!
It was my first show ever. It was the day after my birthday. Best birthday party I could have. When you have tough times, which in our country is not so scarce, it's a relief for you. You truly put all your ambition, thoughts, and dreams into it.
You want to speak out, and there aren't as many outlets as there should be to do this. We found this in metal. It's speaking to us. It's talking about our problems, it's talking about our wars, about our aggression, about our oppression. It's giving us a chance to release all this bottled up anger in a positive way, so we don't have to go and do it in a negative way. Yeah!
Chance to be together and enjoy the time free of political shit outside. So this is something more than important.
it's essential.
Yeah, it's essential.
The stories I've heard from fans here have made me realize just how much is at stake for metalheads in this part of the world. For some of these fans, desert rock is the only place where they can safely show their devotion to heavy metal. And that's far beyond anything I've had to deal with as a metalhead growing up in Canada. So I've traveled over 40,000 kilometers since the Wacken Festival in Germany. But there's one last stop I have to make. I'm heading back to India, to the city of Bangalore, where something historic is about to happen. My favorite band of all time, Iron Maiden, is playing the first major metal show in this country's history. And with 30,000 Indian metalheads lining up at the gates, this is one concert that I have to be a part of.
I don't think you'll hear a louder crowd anywhere in the world because, I mean, we haven't experienced shows like this. So, you know, it's like 20 years of just pent up feelings and stuff is all going to come out. And the minute Bruce hits the stage, we're all going to go like berserk. I think I'm going to like gush fountains.
Surprised that your music is deeply connected with people from so many different cultures?
Well, I suppose it should, but after years and years of traveling around the world, kids are kids. It doesn't matter what culture you come from, at least a certain proportion of kids in whatever cultural society want to get up and just go, ah, like that. And we kind of provide that soundtrack. In the dark, I have a constant fear that something's always here. Fear of the dark. Bangalore! I have a phobia. Someone's always there.
Standing here with India's new generation of metalheads, I can feel the excitement in the air. It's like I'm 13 and I'm back at my first big metal show. I've realized on this journey that although heavy metal may be part of the process of globalization, something unique is happening. Metal connects with people, regardless of their cultural, political, or religious backgrounds. And these people aren't just absorbing metal from the West. They're transforming it, creating a new outlet they can't find in their traditional cultures, a voice to express their discontent with the chaos and uncertainty that surrounds them in their rapidly changing societies. And for metalheads all across the globe, metal is more than music, more than an identity. Metal is freedom, And together, we are now a global tribe.